So yoga was physicalized. I mean, nowadays, Bikram gets the heat for making yoga just a physical system. But Iyengar got the heat in the 40s from the sadhus. They're saying, you're making this yoga that's just about the body. And Iyengar didn't know any better. He didn't get philosophy. He didn't get spiritual practice from his master. He didn't get taught any of that. In fact, he hardly got taught any yoga. On a number of occasions, he said, I only got 10 or 12 lessons from my master. And he talks about those specific lessons in his autobiography. They're like two prime periods in which he was taught by his teacher, like a few months after he went to live with him, and then a couple years later. So he got actually very little physical instruction and zero philosophical instruction from his master. So he was a physical culture yogi. And actually, not even so much because he learned physical culture, but just because that's what he was doing. He was in this milieu of Mysore and Pune, where people just started to pick up on this hot new thing called yoga. Because these guys that I showed in that previous picture, they took that yoga and they made it into a secular practice. The hatha yoga was from the hatha yogis, the guys who were using it as a technology to become enlightened, to become realized. And I'll get to your question in a moment. And in this period of Indian history, when the Indians were looking to their own traditions and trying to find substitutes for Western ways of being, they wanted to find substitutes for physical culture ways of being, and they said, hey, look at these yogis doing these strange contortions in the street. Can we use that for physical culture? Can we use that to build bodies? You know, for us, it's a moot question. We never even think of even questions. It's so automatic. But then it was an unknown quantity. When you read these papers from that era, people like Kodayananda speculated as to whether this would be done. But they did it, and very quickly, it became a popular practice in the country. In fact, that was one of Krishnamacharya's missions, was to spread it throughout the country. Would you pay for him to go around and teach yoga to people? But that was all Iyengar knew. And it wasn't actually until the late 60s that he started to explore the philosophical elements of the practice, the spiritual elements of the practice. He was a great physicalizer of the practice, but what he did is he made the practice export ready. He made it accessible to the West by bringing it just into what we call the Anamaya Kosha, just into the physical body. And so this is our legacy, a yoga of the physical body where we probably, unless we get with a really unique teacher or we pick up something by chance, we don't get the subtle body technologies. We don't learn how the subtle body is constructed. We don't learn how to work with the subtle body. Because this is our yoga. It's a yoga that came through BTS Iyengar, through a physical culture system. It's great that it arrived this way, because now we have a platform to work from and we can go deeper. But Iyengar brought it to us, the way he worked with it with such passion, the way he worked with it so aesthetically. He learned to move prana in his body because part of the way he made his living in the first 10, 15 years of his life is he performed. He was on a mission to popularize yoga. He would get up in front of a crowd and do these amazing yoga postures. He had to create bhava in his body. He had to create energy and charisma. And to do that, he had to create compelling geometric forms. He had to show himself. So this conditioned his understanding of the practice. And in the course of that, he learned new things. He learned how prana moved in the body. He learned how it moved through straight lines, which is something we find in the text. But we didn't find it explained as doing it through the whole body. There's always this talk about having a straight spine, the yogic practices, the meditation practices. But Iyengar took that technology and put it through the whole body, straight lines, stacking the bones, sucking the muscles through the bone, and producing prana that way with the physical body. It had also been done by Theos Bernard sometime before. And Theos Bernard wasn't as popular. He had also aestheticized the postures and gave us a different vision of posture, but it was Iyengar who kind of sealed.
Well, I was just responding to that secularization. I thought there's sort of a myth about Krishnamacharya and his teacher in the Himalayas who said, go be a householder and teach yoga.
Yeah.
It seems to have started the ball rolling towards bringing the yoga into the householder's life.
Not exclusively, because it was like happening all over India at the time. Krishnamacharya was a major player, and that mission that he was given was not unusual. This seemed to be happening a lot. Shivananda gave his lieutenants that same directive. He said, go out and teach Hatha Yoga, have them go later. Shivananda was working in the 20s to learn Hatha Yoga, and he published his first books were on Hatha Yoga. Swami Shivananda, the whole Shivananda tradition, that Shivananda Vedanta centers like we have here. They came to America through this guy, Vishnu Devananda. And then you had the brother of Yogananda. Vishnu Ghosh, his brother, opened a gym devoted to physical culture and yoga in Calcutta in 1923. Before, that was like 1 year after Krishnacharya came out of the cave. So that was happening on the other side of the country in Calcutta. So you had a lot of people who were secularizing the practice at this time. Krishnacharya was definitely a major player, but a lot of people were in the mix.
So, kind of, I guess what I just maybe learned was that some of these poses didn't really come out of like, I mean, he was moving around and kind of experimenting, but he was looking to make something attractive or dynamic or like, wow.
Yes.
Kind of, okay, that is interesting.
Well, he had an aesthetic awareness, you know, I mean, he wanted to be a dancer. He published a whole book called The Art of Yoga, in which his whole book is about the aesthetics of yoga posture. How yoga is an art, just like an artist paints a picture. So he sees yoga very aesthetically. And as far as like where he got the poses and how much they were driven by aesthetic concerns, I would like to know that specifically. I would like to talk to the man and say, how many of these postures did you invent?
Yeah.
And what influenced you to make this posture and that posture? I mean, that would be great information to have.
I mean, don't they have like stories behind each pose? I mean, or most of the poses have a story to accompany it, to kind of give it like life, I guess, right?
Yeah, and we see that in his big book, Life in Yoga. And the question is, did he and the people who collaborated with it, did he make that up just to like give texture to the practice and to the poses? Or is this received knowledge from, it didn't come from Krishnacharya.
Right.
Where was that just in the field? Was he picking those stories up from the, you know, milieus he was in, the social circles he was in? I would love to know that. I would love to talk to the guy. Find out, you know. He's pretty sincere. He's usually a straight shooter. You could probably tell if you were in front of him and asking questions. So I'm going to give you guys a little break. And I'm going to give a homework assignment on the break. I'm going to have you talk to someone next.